St. Mary Major. There is always a buzz of activity around St. Mary Major, like bees to honey. This basilica, the oldest Marian church in the West, has everything to whet a tourist's appetite. One, it has a venerable age. It has never been torn down and rebuilt, and at 1,600 years old, it's like a little sister to the Pantheon. When built in 432, it was the church designed to influence the influencers who lived all around it on the Esquiline Hill. Hi, I'm Liz Lev, and I'm an art historian, and you're listening to the podcast From Tourists to Pilgrims. Two, it has spectacular beauty. The dazzling mosaics that line the nave are the evolution of the ancient Roman embleme found on the floors of the glorious mansions that used to surround the church in antiquity. These square panels of tiny gold and enamel tiles recount Old Testament stories in the chic style pioneered by the nearby Column of Trajan. And three, it has excitement. Every August 5th, to celebrate its foundation, white rose petals are scattered from the ceiling, and lucky visitors might spot the Pope coming to pray before the miraculous icon of the Madonna Salus Populi Romani before and after every apostolic journey. St. Mary Major is piled high with beauty and treasures. It's like the Christian version of Ali Baba's cave. To complement the dazzling decor, one can imagine the parade of celebrities that have crossed its threshold. Bernini was discovered and buried here. Michelangelo designed the Sforza Chapel and was also supposed to be buried here. The notorious Borgia Pope Alexander VI gave the gold from the New World to decorate the ceiling, while the body of the sainted Pope Pius V is displayed on the right transept chapel. Perhaps the eye of the tourist might be clouded by the display of worldly wonders, puzzled by the opulence. It takes the eye of the pilgrim to see the meaning behind the splendor. Note the rhythmic succession of matching columns leading the eye down the nave. There are 42, the same number as the generations from Abraham to Jesus. Those mosaics recount the journey to the fulfillment of the promise in the stories of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, as well as the exploits of Moses and Joshua. Soldiers marching, shepherds herding is what stands out in those tiles, everything recounting a journey. Through time from generation to generation, from Old Testament to New Testament, from Ur to Egypt to the Promised Land to Rome. Promise is key in understanding these mosaics. God made a promise, a covenant, to each of the patriarchs figured in those mosaics, and we follow this historical journey through the nave to its fulfillment at the altar. Below our feet, the stunning 12th century cosmatesque pavement with its interlocking circles speaks to the generations who have walked this path before us. Each design is different, as are the circumstances, the concerns, and the states of the souls that have made their way down this same nave. the path of history, revelation, and decoration all meet at the altar surmounted by a triumphal arch. This type of monument, invented by the Romans as a symbol of military victory, became for Christianity the symbol of Christ's triumph over sin and death. Those stunning tiles, made from 180 different types of enamel, cluster to illustrate the fulfillment of God's covenant. Not with Jesus' suffering and death, but with the incarnation, the beginning of Jesus' own pilgrimage on earth. St. Mary Major has long been the Christmas church, Rome's Bethlehem, especially during the long years when pilgrims were unable to journey to the Holy Land. Here, the Gospels of Luke and Matthew are recounted in surprising visual form. The Annunciation presents Mary as a princess, complete with golden gowns surrounded by angel attendants. The birth of Christ, the great moment of the Word made flesh, is absent. Perhaps it was too rough and humble to persuade the great influencers of the imperial court of Mary's role as God-bearer, as declared the Council of Ephesus in 431. The narrative continues with the presentation at the temple, looking like a courtly reception in an imperial basilica. But as the angel awakens Joseph in the lower right corner, the story changes to that of a voyage. Below, an apocryphal moment of Christ's arrival in Egypt, bringing about the conversion of the people of Sutton and Hierapolis, foretells the arrival of the Magi from faraway lands who undertook that first great pilgrimage seeking answers as they followed a distant star. Gazing upon the exotically dressed figures with the pointed caps of foreigners, or in Rome, the pointed cap of the freed slave, the wondrous message was that all pilgrims from all over are welcome to the presence of Christ, and those who seek Jesus and find him will be freed from the slavery of sin. A glittering happy ending in the treasure trove of a church, but turning our attention downwards, we see what lies at the core of the basilica, the relic of the simple wooden slabs of Christ's crib. Directly above, Peter and Paul stand at the apex of the arch, flanking an empty throne. But Jesus is not there. He has come to earth, taking on the humble guise of man. In the words of Pope Benedict XVI, "So here the procession of history and all the splendor of the mosaics is abruptly pulled down into the cave, into the stable. The images fall down into reality." All this beauty grew from the most inauspicious of soil. A child born in a cave and placed in an animal's trough. A pilgrim destined to redeem humanity during his brief time on earth. But despite those humble beginnings and his brutal death on the cross, Jesus brought the promise of eternal glory. Looking from those simple sticks of wood to the magnificent basilica, we see the potential of faith to create beauty, even out of the most difficult circumstances.
Thank you. You've been listening to From Tourist to Pilgrim, a podcast written and narrated by Liz Lev, produced by Johanna Bronkova and Mara Micheli.